All right, let's start. Hello, welcome to TechHead Australia. My name is Marat Bakirov, sorry for my Russian pronunciation. And I work at Redify as a senior developer. I'm also a SharePoint MVP. And today we're going to talk about the apps. It's something around the same apps. It's the same apps that Brian was telling about. But I'm going to show some code. Who wants to see some code? Anyone? Yeah, you don't like code. Should like code. Okay, few questions. This question is ridiculous right now because I see who have not been here. And who tried to create apps for SharePoint? I tried, trust me. Who has an Office 365 account? Okay, you're a champion. Who tried JavaScript object model for SharePoint? Okay, so understand a little bit what I will talk about. So I will start. I have a very short session. It's half an hour, so I don't expect to have 8 or something bullets. So we have 4 bullets. We'll start with a little bit of what is SharePoint app, and I will show some pictures. And the first picture I will show is a normal scary picture that I believe you've seen many times. Who have seen this picture? Yeah. Who do you expect me to spend half an hour on this picture, on every detail? I do not. So I will try to create somewhat simplified pictures. Let's talk first about the SharePoint hosted app. SharePoint hosted app, you have your manifest that stores in SharePoint, and manifest defines basically what is an app. App is a package, it has zip file, yeah, with the manifest and some other stuff. And it tells us and tells SharePoint, if you go to that page, this page is hosted by the app, and the app should do some code. And you have your code in JavaScript, REST, or whatever, that talks to SharePoint, that basically what's your functionality, that's what you're doing. If you talk about the cloud-hosted app, which are provided, hosted, and auto-hosted, things look the same at the first. So you have your package, you deploy it to SharePoint, you run the page, and this is your app. But the key thing is, your app doesn't run on SharePoint. Your app is running somewhere else, and it's very important. Your app is running or on a Windows Azure that's bound to Office 365, or on your own website. And this site can have a server code. I often heard the Microsoft guy saying, oh, okay, you have server code in your apps. It's really a server code. Server code is important, like for validation or whatever, right? You cannot do it in a client. It will be easily hacked. But from a SharePoint perspective, this is a client code. So I wanted to point out that when you're doing apps, there is no server code from a SharePoint perspective. This is a very important. Basically, the goal of my presentation was to go through some pain points I've seen when I tried to learn what is an app, some things that I thought were not obvious. So the first thing, no server code, okay? Okay, we got it. A little bit about app hosting. It's also kind of standard side. First option is you have is your provider hosted app. And basically what it means is when a user opens a page in SharePoint app, what happens is it's redirected to your site, www.yourverymegacompanysite.com, something like that. Oh, .com.au, sorry. Right? And you have to think, as Brian said in his previous session, you have to think that many users, you can have 10 users, or even, sorry, 10 apps installed, or 10,000 apps installed, and each of them will go to your site. And your site and your application has to be multi-tenant. You don't want users from other site or to see data from other site, right? You don't want it. So you have to think very much about the architecture of your app. On the contrary, the auto-hosted app is kind of simpler. So basically, in your package, there is an app, basically an ISP.NET app, or it could be a SQL database also. And when you install your app in SharePoint, what happens is Office 365 automatically deploys it to the Windows Azure websites. I will show you. Do you guys like slides or code, by the way? Code is okay for you? Okay, so I could switch from English to C#, I don't know. So, and then you have a SharePoint hosted that basically has no server code in any meaning. So what you could do with apps? Basically the main scenarios you could do with apps is you can do just a full page. Your app will be a page, and on your page you do whatever you want. This is basically you have customers saying, hey, give me 3 buttons, if I press that button, you will do that one. Everybody has seen it, right? But what you could also do, you could do a part. What is an app part? Basically, I think users will not understand very much the difference between web part and the app part. From the user perspective, it's kind of web part. I can say edit page, add app part, or whatever. This is a web part. But from your perspective, it's something that runs inside your frame, and inside your frame, there is your app. But it can be added to the page. And also, there is lots of other stuff. I didn't put all, everything, but one of the important things is UI command extensions. Everybody know UI extensions in SharePoint? You know this. Ribbons, menus, whatever. You can do this in apps. And I also have a sample of that. Some challenges you will find out. Well, let's start with SharePoint hosted apps. Some challenges you first you will find out. First, SharePoint provides you an isolation. When you have your pages or whatever in your SharePoint hosted app, it's not running on that your SharePoint site. It's creating a site which is called App Web. And it's not just the contoso.sharepoint.com/site/your application site. You see the URL is different from the very root, right? And this lead us to another problem we'll talk a little bit later. If you're developing a SharePoint hosted app, you can do whatever you want. I promised you a code, by the way, but I also have it in Visual Studio. Basically, you can do like you used to. Anybody use the client object model? Already asked. Yeah? You just client context, load, run query, whatever. You can do something more sophisticated, like, or you can use the REST APIs, whatever. But, sorry. As your code is running not on that site, it's a different URL. What you'll face it is a same origin policy. Everybody knows the same origin policy problem? So basically, from that site, you cannot go to another site. You know, I was thinking about putting a Boromir picture saying one cannot simply put, simply access host web from app web, but decided it's not suitable for the head. But okay, so what we can do with that? SharePoint provides us an infrastructure for that problem. So it has a thing called app context site. If you do code like this, so two things. First, we'll talk a little bit later about permissions, but your app need to have permissions. When you're doing something on your app web, it's basically your site. You can do whatever you want. Create, delete something, whatever. It's your database, it's your storage, do whatever you want. But if you want to access a host web, you need permissions for that. And if you have permissions, what you can do is you can create something called app context. And if you're creating that one, you basically later on work just the same way you used to, but just with another context, okay? So I had a feeling that you're a little bit tired of the slides. Do you mind if I switch to Visual Studio? Okay? Wake up, wake up. All right. So I have three apps here. And first, I will show you one app I made in the auto-hosted mode. It's a very simple app. Basically, I copied it from MSDN. And what it's doing is, here you have your solution. Basically, solution in Visual Studio is created very simple. When you install the SDK, you just create a file, new project, whatever. And you have your pages. Here's my first page. And it's a very simple sample you can find in MSDN. It shows you a number of lists. Shows you a list from your site. And if you run it, sorry, it's not from there, not there, not there. Damn it. Sorry. This is the right place. Just a moment. By the way, this is my developer site. So I use it when I develop apps, and so I can use Visual Studio to deploy apps directly from Visual Studio. So here's my site. Do you see? Or should I make it bigger? Is it okay? And here is my app. And we are going to redirect it to another page. And if you see here, it's a different URL. So I had my site called mbakirov366 because 365 was already busy. But here's another URL. But okay, here's a sample app. You can create a list. You can get count of lists. And the first thing that make me think of what's going wrong is what I have run this app, and I went to my site, and here's my site, and started to think. Wait a moment, I've just pushed a button that create me a list. Where the hell is this list? Oh, sorry, it's not that. Site content. And at that moment, I realized the concept of the app web and the host web. So the code you have seen here using the default client object model. And this default model, if you don't do anything specific, just goes with your app web. Okay? So let's try to do something with that. I have another simple program that will do a very simple stuff. It will just get a title from a host web. But it's a whole bunch of the app context, permissions, or whatever. So I have a second page here. And here is the code for that page. It does some basic stuff. When your app is first run, you have some parameters. You can find like a host URL, app URL. You can find where you are. And then it runs, loads some scripts you will need from SharePoint. And after them, it runs that code. So you create a client context. You create the app context site. And after that, you just doing. It's again a client object model. Everything is asynchronous. You know, it's execute query async, whatever. And then you get the title. Very simple app. And the other thing I need to do is there's an app manifest. And here you have permissions. And I needed to get the permissions to read web. Okay? So what will happen if you deploy this app? SharePoint will ask me if I trust this app, right? Okay, I will show you the ready app. So here's my second link. Here's my app running. It takes a little bit time. So you'll see the page. Oh, sorry. That one. See the page, and after some time, the title appears. It's because it's a whole bunch of asynchronous call. Normally, I try to say, to measure time it takes to appear and try to find out what I'm speaking at this moment. And this moment already should be there. All right, hope it will be there sometime. So, yeah. Oh my God. All right. So, do you believe it should be there? I close it. I know what I've done. I've deployed an app over a site. I made different sites. It should not be there, but okay. So, basically, what we have seen is permissions, client object model, what you can do with the client object model, and the app context. Let's go to the second part, a little bit more about the cloud hosted app. So, what's a cloud? Why would we like to use cloud hosted app? First of all, it's a server code we all like to use, ASP.NET server code. Everybody loves JavaScript? Anybody? Who prefers C#? Woo! Right. So, second very important point is elevation of privileges. Who knows the construction like spsecurity.run with elevated privileges? Any of SharePointers? Do you use it? Yeah, so it has a very useful meaning. We have something that the app should do and the user should not do, like maybe log in something details, do some calculations, whatever, right? So for example, you store somewhere, I don't know, the sum of the order with all the discounts at the current moment or whatever, right? We don't want the user to have access to that data. Or he will change this data and will say, okay, I have my order for $1. Is it a Ferrari? I don't know. It's in your system. Just give me your Ferrari. My Ferrari. So this is a very important part. And the third part, it's not possible in SharePoint hosted app, is remote event receivers. What is remote Well, everybody knows what's event receiver, right? Like a trigger in SQL. You know triggers in SQL. Something changes, a list item appears or something else, and your app should react to that, right? So in this model, you have cloud-hosted apps. We can have our code, and remember, it runs outside of SharePoint, right? And this code could have a receiver that subscribes to an event that happens to SharePoint. So a little bit more about app permissions. I think it's very important stuff. So the first is that permissions are configured in the application manifest. Luckily, you can do it in XML. You can open XML and make your permissions. It better say permissions request. So what apps need to have. Or you can use Visual Studio, just like you have seen. I used Visual Studio to have operators permissions. Second, when the user installs an app, what happens is there's a screen saying, do you trust this app to do this, 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 and this? So there's, for example, if you have permissions, I want to read user profiles, I have to write to the web, write to the list, or whatever. It's all listed there. And yeah, and the thing is that permissions are given at once. So if your app wants one, two, three permissions, user should give access all of them. The user cannot say, okay, maybe I could give rights for the list, but not for user profile. There's no option. You trust it up or you don't trust it up. Second is the user who is installing an app is given the permissions. And it means that this user should have these permissions. If you don't have access to something and the app wants to have access, you can't install an app. Simple as that. And in the we'll talk a little bit about app policies on the next slide, but what will happen when you have your apps? Your app has permissions and the user who's running an app, it's not the guy who installed it, it's another guy who's running an app, right? The user should have also some permissions, and how we combine that, it's all done by Azure Access Control Service. So a little bit about app policies. So what you can do is first policy, which is a default, is app plus user. What does it mean? Just I have said already. You have an app, it can do this. You have a user, it can do this. They both should have right for access list, access user profile, search, or whatever. If they both have it, it's okay. But we have been talking about elevation. There is a second thing called app-only policy, which means that you say, okay, my app will do something without context of a user. So if the app has permission for that, we don't care if a user can do this or not. Just let me do that. Okay, this is the second part, and I'll show in a minute how we can set up this. App-only policy. We can use app-only policy for elevation, or we can use it for when we sometimes want to do something and we do not want to track a user who's done that. So how it's done? It's very easy. There is application XML, the manifest. There is an option called allow app-only policy. You set it to true, and in Visual Studio there is checkbox if you go through the tabs, says somewhere is checkbox. But you need to, in order to user to install this app, he has to be a site admin, right? So, I will show later in the code this. The second part we need to do, if we're just using our normal code, this will run under this, under app plus user policy. If you want to run under an app policy, we need to play a little bit different. When you create a SharePoint app, Visual Studio creates a token helper class for us, right? To help us deal with all these OAuth tokens or whatever, right? This is a normal call you do when you start doing with the, working with your host web. And this is two different calls, which are, where is my laser? Which are a little bit different. But after that, you also have a kind of your client context. But if you run this app under this context, there will be no checking, there will be no user, no checking of user permissions. So another point I would like to stress out is it's very, very common mistake. And the problem I had when I was doing my first one day or something of the presentation. Oh, sorry, of the playing with apps. So I have my page. And what I've done is I've done a F5 refresh. Anybody done that? And I got a strange error saying that something like cannot extract token from session. Say what? So what happens? The first time your app is called, you have the post call, and in the form data of the post, it's not in the URL, you have this token. And if you are lazy enough, you don't store this token, and you have an app, for example, that has a post back. I will show you an app that has two buttons, and the buttons are server code, and it has post back, obviously. So what happens, you can lose this token. So this is the kind of pattern I'm using. So I'm storing this token in a session. They made it a little bit simpler if you have a Studio 2013. They have some MVC app for SharePoint 13. And this pattern, there's some specific attributes you can do, so you don't have this problem. But if you're still using 12, Studio 12 like I do, you should think of that. And don't forget it's a post. If you're doing MVC, by default everything is get, right? Don't forget it's post, or you'll spend time saying, hey, why am I, my code, why it's not called, or whatever. Don't forget, the first call is always post. Later you do whatever you want, but the first call to your app is always post, okay? I made it clear. Okay, Brian mentioned Chrome control. Anybody played with Chrome control? Who knows what is it? Anybody else? So you like some explanation. What is a Chrome control? Chrome control is a JavaScript stuff you could put into your page, and your page will do several things. First of all, it will have a nice blue bar on the top. It's done for the users, because when a user go from the SharePoint, it has a nice blue bar to your app that doesn't have a nice blue bar. They start complaining. Everybody has users who are complaining on stuff like that. Yeah, I bet you have, right? And another important thing, it takes the styles from your SharePoint site. So your app uses the styles from your SharePoint site, and then makes your app looks consistent, so it looks more like SharePoint site, like your SharePoint site. It's done for the users, you know. And also you can have a menu you can customize, so in your JavaScript you can do something, so it makes your menu. It's not that menu you have in Office 365. You don't have here Outlook, admin, or whatever, but anyhow it looks like, and also you can have a link that goes you back to your site. So, are you tired of slides? Anybody? Let's try to go to Visual Studio. So, what I have in my Visual Studio? Okay. First app is, I have two apps. One of them is auto-hosted, another is SharePoint hosted. What you can do with the auto-hosted app, the thing I like most is that I pressed F5 button. What happens when you press F5 button in auto-hosted app? You know what happens? Visual Studio packs an app, but in an app you should specify a URL for your app, for your server, right? Where do you go from SharePoint? And it specifies local host. So what happens? You have your app. Your app is installed on your SharePoint site, but inside this app you do some stuff, and you are redirected to your local host. And your local host is on your machine, right? Sorry, ignore that. It's not an error. A local host is your machine, which means you can debug stuff. I find this awesome. I don't know what you think about that. Yeah, this is a promise that you will have this prompt. This is the permissions from the site, from the app. And I can have two choices, trust it or not. What do you prefer this time? Trust, okay. Yeah, I could press cancel, but I will just waste 5 minutes of your time to run it again. And what happens, you see I'm in the debug. You see that? Okay, I press F10, whatever. I have a 5. I found this awesome. All right, I'll stop debugging. Second thing I wanted to show is remote event receiver. What is remote and event receiver? How you can do that? You have an auto-hosted. I think I need a little bit of explanation. When you have your auto-hosted or provided hosted app, you have basically two projects. On top, you have a SharePoint Office or SharePoint project. Basically, this is your app, and this is your ASP.NET app, okay, which is deployed to Azure or to your site. So, on top, I have this SharePoint project. I have say add new item event remote event receiver, and just like you have a normal event receiver, you can have list item events, and you can say select which list, and you can select which events you'd like to subscribe on. A limitation of Visual Studio here is here you only have lists on your app web, right? So something you created. But if you subscribe for another event, which is also possible for an app installing, you can have some code that will bind your remote event receiver to the host web, so don't worry. I won't show this code right now. So, what I have here, yeah, what is an event receiver? Event receiver is basically a WebCF service. I have my zoom in here. You see that SVC, right? It's WebCF service. And depending on the type of receiver, you have basically a receiver with return or not. So this is a synchronous receiver. Each item is updating, adding, you know. And this is a updated, added, whatever. And there are some more tricks here. What does this receiver? It's very simple. You have a call. You have a list. I'm adding a new list item. What I want to do, I have a second column called title 2. I want to have title 2 equal to title, right? It's very simple. But if you have a normal event receiver, you have your properties and you play with them. But this is a WCF call, right? So you have this. This came from SharePoint as a copy, and you need to go something back. That's why code is a little bit different. You're saying result, you see that? Change it item properties is equal to blah, blah, blah. So it's something you return from WCF call, right? Want to see this in action? Yeah? Okay, so here's my site, here's my second app. I will first run the ASP.NET page that will use Chrome control, and that will show me a URL of app web, right? So here is the auto-hosted app. It basically gets some basic information. I took this from MSDN. This page gets some basic information, what the list we have or whatever. And have you seen that at first it was no blue bar there and it just appeared later on? This is a Chrome control. It uses JavaScript, asynchronous call or whatever, so it takes it time to load. But okay. I have my website. And I will go, I think it's called lists. List one. Just a pause, just wait a moment. Come on, yeah. And what I'm making is I make a new list item, right? Let's say tech head. Is it okay? I'm saving an item. You see that? It works, right? It's a little bit more trickier to debug the remote event receivers because when you have a normal app, you have just a redirect basically done in the browser. But remote event receiver is called by SharePoint. So you want SharePoint to call your local host, you need to play a little bit more with Azure Service Bus, you know? But we won't cover this right now. So I have some more cool stuff. So I have a thing called client web part. Do you want to see how we create the client web parts? Yeah. So here you say new item. It's simple as that. It's called client web part, and it asks you where is your page. It can create a new page for you, or you can use an existing page you have. So what I've done here, I created a client web part. It basically use page kind of the same as default as PX I had. And what I've done is I just added it to the page. So it's as simple as that. Page, edit, and here you have insert, and here you have app part. Come on. And here you have your app part. And I've already done that, and here is your app part that runs inside SharePoint. Okay, so another cool stuff I have in number 3. So I'm a little bit out of time. Do you have 5 more minutes? I'm interested, want to show that? Yeah, so my third solution is a provider hosted app. So before, when I deployed that, I deployed the ASP.NET part manually to the Azure websites I've created for myself. And I play a little bit with the app to say, okay, this is an app, this is my ASP.NET app, they are connected. I won't I won't go over that right now. I wanted to show the custom action. What I've done is I created a custom action. Is it okay with the sound? Because something with my microphone. Is it okay? Okay. And here you have your custom action. Basically, you have menu and ribbon. And the cool thing is that when Visual Studio creates a section, you have a choice, app web or host web, right? So what I've done here, I've done a custom action that's in a ribbon, and it's I think it's bind to list of the type 100, which is basically a custom list, right? And what I have inside my custom action is I have a page. One more thing. And this custom action goes redirected to my page. And in here, I provide the list ID and list item ID. So when you have your item selected in the list, when I call my page, it knows where we are, right? So let's go over the code we have in the page. So the page is basically very simple. It has two buttons. I call them button and button. And the first one, they're a little bit different. So let's go over code. Here, I'm using that pattern I've shown you recently. Because when you have your button, this is postback, right? You always have a second call, and no one will store this token for you. You're giving it once, so I'm storing it in the session, because I will need it second time and third time the button is pressed. And the button click handlers are very similar. First one just, goes over to my list and adds a new item with GUID, just random item. But the second one uses a little bit different calls. Remember I told you, it uses the app only policy. So it creates an item without a user. And the code itself later on is the same. And one more thing I wanted to show is this one. You see that? And if you go over in editor, it's somewhere, that one. See that? So let's run the app. Okay, this app has a custom action, so we need to go over the site. So this is my custom list and has two items at this moment. Just a moment. I think it's because of Firefox. Not sure. I don't know. All right, I can even delete these items to be more. Damn it, that's why I don't like Windows 8 sometimes. So you see everything that happens in Facebook, why I don't want that. Here I have a ribbon, and in this ribbon I have my button. Come on, give me a ribbon, that one. It's called ribbon custom action. And just for simplicity, I will open another page with the same list so we can see the list, right? So right now, I have this list. I press in my, just a moment. We'll press it here. So I'm pressing my button. I'm redirected to my app. So which button we will call first, button or button? Button, okay. All right. Come on. Button. Okay. We call button. It does some stuff. And we refresh a list. So this first button, which is a button, creates a normal item in a normal way. Come on, refresh it. You know, this Ajax stuff, caching, whatever, you need to refresh it properly. Come on. I'm sorry, it's internet like this. Come on. Yeah, this is just a normal list item, but you see, SharePoint, they have new fields called app created by. You have normal created by user, which is me, by the way, this is me. And they also have a which was an app that's created that item, right? Let's call the button right now, the second one, okay? And refresh a list, I'm pressing Ctrl F5. F5 sometimes is not enough. You know, this Ajax stuff, caching, whatever. So we have new fancy UI, and sometimes it's just, yeah. Here's the second one. You see that? So this is an app-only call. Okay, as I'm very short of time, that's all for the demos today. Basically, yeah, that's all. And just some highlights, I just want to close my session. So don't forget the things that your app is called with the post. Don't forget that no one will store the token for you. This you have to think of. And remember some cool stuff. F5 is cool. Don't forget about Chrome control. And I want to have a kind of recap of what we were saying before. We've looked through the different type of apps, of the architecture, of how you make code of that. And I want you to remember some things. I want to remember that this is a client code only. Don't forget, we don't have a server code in SharePoint. Don't forget that there is an app web. And you can be confused when you're working with a SharePoint code that you're working with a different site. Don't forget you have two sites. Don't forget about the post. Don't forget about permissions. And don't forget the apps are cool and have lots of stuff there. It's not the old stuff. This is my last real slide. It's a call to action. So if you want to play with that, it's simple as that. You install web platform installer. Oops, sorry. You find Office and find this stuff, developer tools. Just go install that. It's as simple as that. Thank you. I will appreciate if you go and fill the evaluation form that the head organizers give you. Not for every evaluation form, but they have a kind of lottery. You can have a chance for that. And this is some more resources. Thank you very much.